Okay, let's see. Well, this is a picture of Michael and Danny when Danny's about 1 year old there. You can check out those baby cheeks on the guy. And this one, my favorite pictures. This is Michael and Danny. The Christmas, about 3 years later. Danny's, I think, four. This is Michael right after this shot was taken, just, you know, started strangling Danny or something. This is this Christmas, I think, after their mom and I got divorced. And here they are, the summer that they spent with me after that. I think that's the summer that Michael had his accident. This is Michael in the hospital. And this is a few years later. Danny and I are just taking a trip somewhere, some diner or something. Oh, this is great. This is Marianne. This is Danny's stepmom. It's a nice shot. I think Danny was about 10 when I took this picture. Oh, look at this. This is Danny taking his first driving lesson. He could hardly see over the steering wheel. Of course, now he's taller than me, and, you know, we wear the same shoes. Oh, this is cool. This is, I think this is Danny's freshman year in high school, and this is him in his band uniform.
Good evening, and welcome to the oldest lighted field in continuous use in the United States.
This is the story of the year I spent with the Decatur High Marching Band.
I was trying to turn in the air when I was trying to do it.
No, Josh, you're going to kick me in the face, man. 3 years old. You're going to kick me in the face. We have an impression. Don't do that.
Let's go.
Now, there's nothing particularly special about the Decatur High Marching Band. They don't win state competitions. They don't get invited to march in the Macy's or Rose parades. They're really just a pretty average bunch of high school band kids who have fun at football games no matter who happens to be winning. During this game in particular, their team was getting trounced. There is one thing special about the band, though. My son's in it. Danny's 16. A couple of years ago, he was 6. Suddenly, he's the age that I look at as the start of my adult life, an age when every day means something and details count. I still remember those days with all their twists and turns, their heartaches, even boredom. And every year was a milestone. When I turned 16, I didn't just get older. I thought I'd entered another universe. Now that I'm in my 40s, time's measured in decades. I mean, who cares whether you're 36 or 37? It's whether you're in your 30s, 40s, or 50s that counts. And the scary thing is that the less time I have ahead of me, the more it seems to speed up. For Danny, time exploded when he was 7. That's the year his brother Michael died. Michael was 9 then, and his death sent Danny spiraling inward. I remember the day Michael died, Danny told me that he wanted to be like the little prince, living alone on his tiny planet, protected from pain.
It didn't really faze me, and I don't, you know, I guess I just couldn't let it faze me at that point in my life, because, you know, it was such a big event to happen to me. You know, 7 years old. Michael pretty much was my world at that time, and he was gone. And so I just kind of turned away from it. about a week after Michael died, we were back at Mike's house, and I was sitting on the porch, and our friend from across the street, I don't remember his name, he was my age, but he was Michael's friend. That's the way most of the things worked. And he came by, and he was like, he said, is Michael here? I need somebody to help me put an inner tube in my tire on my bike. And I said, no, Michael's dead. He said, oh, that's too bad. And he went home. And I just continued doing whatever I was doing.
And that's pretty much what characterized Danny for years. He, all through middle school and even into his first year in high school, he just protected himself emotionally. But then, the first game of his sophomore year, I went to the football game and I looked over into the band section, and there was this teenager. He was laughing. He had friends. He was dancing. I had never ever seen Danny dance before, and I knew that I just had to be part of this. I mean, I had to be there. I had to see this transformation that was going on in Danny's life. And for me, the only way to do that was to make a film. So I knew what I had to do. I had to go back to high school. But the minute I walked into this place, I got a really strange feeling. It wasn't the kids, it was the place. The buildings seemed to be mocking me. When you're a student, you think you own them. They're your home, and you get to know every hallway, every locker and windowsill. But then you leave. They belong to someone else, and you're history. And as I walk around here, they seem to be saying, what do you think you're doing here, old man? But I couldn't let them intimidate me because I came to find my teenage son.
It wasn't very nice.
Sorry about that.
I've had my shoes longer than you've had your shoes. You're not allowed to wear them until I'm done with these.
That's him the day his wisdom teeth were pulled.
Look, it's better than if I wore the same shoes that my dad wore.
That's true. But then people wouldn't know you're my dad.
See, Danny and I hadn't lived together since the divorce. Ours was that weekend holidays relationship so many dads have today, and I guess we did okay, but I was never really sure how well I knew him or him me. Now he's growing up. Pretty soon it's going to be up to him whether or not we even see each other, and I wonder who he sees when he looks at me. Jesus, what if it's the same kind of guy I see when I look at my dad?
Whole day and night must scramble for a living, feed a wife and children, say his daily prayers, and who has the right as master of the house to have the final word at home? The papa! Tradition! The papa!
I love my dad. He's a great guy. And he loves me. It's just my life he's had a little problem with. That's him and me in a typical moment. I guess when my sisters and I were teenagers, our lives really threatened him. Of course, we were teenagers in the 60s, so, well, he had a point. But it's almost like there was some kind of 11th commandment, thou shalt criticize thy teenager's world. And believe it or not, he's still like that. He still drives us crazy with his concern. Not that I would ever do that with Danny. I mean, when I look at his world, I love it. It's infectious. Maybe it's my own form of nostalgia, but I love being around these kids because for them, the world is brand new, and I miss that feeling. And if there's anything I learned from my father's relationship with the teenage me, it's that if I really want to know my son, I've got to know his world. So I figured, okay, I'll just blend in and become one of the gang.
You're going to be here that long.
I'm going to be here all year.
Oh, my gosh. Who brought him here?
What's it for?
Doing a film about the band. Not about you guys. About
the band.
Yeah.
Hey, man. David, if I get in trouble,
would
So the name of the movie gonna be Band Thugs and Harmony, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, like he wants it to be like Kids, you know, like that movie Kids. You never saw that movie? Kids with all the with the kids in the movie called Kids, about the kids.
Decatur is a small community just outside Atlanta, and like every community in America, it's two worlds. On one side of these tracks is Agnes Scott Women's College and a comfortable middle class, and on the other, a place called The Apartments. But the kids all meet at Decatur High.
What you do is you walk by someone and you say, do you believe in love at first sight, or should I walk by you again? But he's going to be in our band.
This is Chris, who's Danny's best friend.
Skinny White Boys. Danny hasn't told you about that?
No, he hasn't.
No, Skinny White Boys. It's an alternative band.
Do you have any European in you?
Do you want some?
Cameron. Well, no wonder you don't go out on many dates.
Come on. Oh, look who's talking.
And this is Eric, who wants to be drum major someday.
You know, Eric, he plays so much, he just beat on everything in the house. You know, he plays so much, he just bam, bam, all around the house, he just beat, you know. Eric, cut it out, you know.
We had a jazz band. I was in middle school, private middle school, we had a jazz band.
But you know what I have always wished? I have always wished that if I could have me a nice home, you know, and a little basement or something, so everyone could have, you know, little keyboards and, you know, drums and music-wise, you know, because they knew
it.
You know?
Didn't cut me off.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Didn't cut me off. Well, I don't even know what I'm talking about now. I'm talking about something.
Don't you get tired of this stuff?
Yeah.
I bet you would, because I'd hate like following teenagers around when I was an adult and actually had a life.
Chris grew up in an all-white suburb of Birmingham, Alabama, while Eric moved to Decatur from an Atlanta housing project.
Coming here, I mean, I went to Renfrew, and I had never seen so many black people in my entire life together at one time. I don't even know if I'd seen that many black people in my entire life at all, except for maybe when we did church services with the black church across town. And I was scared out of my mind.
Okay, when I was in Atlanta, we had about two white people, like two or three white people that I knew. And they wanted to act black, you know what I'm saying? But they wanted to be black, but I don't care how black they wanted to be. I still didn't like the all races. I ain't like white people, either way it go. So I ain't like them.
I'm tired, man. I'm so sick of school, I could just die.
And then there's Bert, who, well, he's Bert.
It's hard to be me and go to school.
You should have seen how many cops they sent out there just for little old me. There's like four cars, like with two cops. That was like what, eight cops. That's just crazy. I told you they just bored. Hey, Mr. Anderson, can I go to the library?
Now, the new music, man, the stuff they come out with today makes me want to kill a dog or something, man. It makes me sick. They sing about the dumbest stuff. I heard some guy singing about his sweater unraveling. I mean, man, that's not a song. That's not DP. And the sad thing is, you know, people are out there like, yeah, man, I can see that thing unraveling, man. It's unraveling.
We have this song that's the most beautiful song in the world called Fuck the Police.
And this is Erin, the drill team captain and class president. Believe it or not, she and Bert are lifelong friends.
Who was all stupid back then?
You and all the people you hang out with.
I don't hang out with anybody. I go home and do my homework.
Whatever.
Dollface.
Now, Greg and Amber, they've got each other.
She's Dollface, I'm Muffin. Sometimes we go out and get stuff to eat.
Yeah.
When Greg has money.
When Greg's mom has money.
When Greg's mom gives Greg money so Greg has money. Greg needs a job. His girlfriends are expensive.
Yeah, it's
not fun anymore. It's Fazan. Like, Amber is Fazan.
Kate and Cameron aren't what you'd call close friends, but they've got a lot in common. They both have something wrong with them, or so they've been told.
It was diagnosed when I failed first grade. You know, everyone went, wait a minute.
It's ADD, which is attention deficit disorder, and a little bit of dyslexia. But I just have trouble all the way around in school. It's been, I struggle through school.
Line, I think, impacts your back circle, your back arc.
And of course, there are the adults, the leaders. Mr. Anderson, who's told the same jokes for 15 years.
If he had violence in a marching band, probably just.
I don't believe in violence.
Oh, well.
Oh, violins. Oh. Now, large instruments, tubas, the metal sousaphones. If it starts lightning anywhere close by, give those to the freshmen.
And his sidekick, Mr. Streeter, who, well, everyone's had a Mr. Streeter in high school.
Across the field! Look down there! Are you even? Do you guys have a clue?
So what's your assessment of high school?
It sucks. I don't think it's that bad. Except for people all, like, gossipy and stuff.
Yeah. And then there are the freshmen.
You should talk. What do I say? I don't know. Never mind.
Wait.
I repeat, I don't spread.
I try and stay away from the freshman girls because it makes us look bad.
Now, Danny explained to me the particular relationship that exists between freshman girls and junior boys at Decatur High.
What's the deal with that?
Yeah.
Just a bunch of horny junior guys are looking for vulnerable, inexperienced girls.
I especially like juniors.
And the freshman girls are in complete awe of the junior guys. It's like, it's these big... It's their first experience with men.
Men?
No, freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior boys all suck. I'm sorry.
That's true. They're all boys are just bad in general until they're like 30-something and mature.
No,
No. Some 30-year-olds are mature.
But most importantly, there's Mary Ellen. Because for the first time in his life, Danny's in love. And it's not going too well.
Mary Ellen's not really my girlfriend, and probably never will be my girlfriend, and never has been my girlfriend.
You see, Danny's a junior, and Mary Ellen's a senior, off to college next year. But actually, it's a lot more complicated than that.
It's just very difficult, I'm sure, to be supportive of someone who's anorexic.
And I don't know how to bring it up, but Mary Ellen has never really talked to me about her anorexia, and I don't know if it'd be wise to just ask her one day about it or not, but I don't know, I'm too chicken to do that.
In fifth grade, I chose not to join band. Without exception, all of my classmates signed up for instruments.
Molly's a poet. She's been Danny's friend and confidant for years.
Instruments are passed down like books, the signature of our teenage ancestors still lingering in spit.
We are 80%. That means 20% of you are sucking on the mouthpieces. That means you're holding the horn for decoration only. You know who you are.
See, all right, we're just going to have two big circles like this, which is going to be balls, all right, testicles, okay? And then we have, like, the rest of the band makes this big penis like this, but the drill team comes from the back.
Thank you.
And for the 4 weeks of band camp, Danny stayed close to Mary Ellen. Chris fine-tuned his pickup lines. Eric worked on his stick flashes while the trumpets tried to find their groove. Kate and Cameron kept in step. Amber danced while Greg watched. Aaron led the troops, and Bert was Bert. And the leaders sweated and strained while they all got ready to take the field in that ritual of high school rituals. Friday night football.
If he's playing this basketball, hit it! Stop! Turn, get the ball! What's so hard about that? They don't take no defense to do it. They don't need no defense, man.
This period, absolute hell.
Let's go out there and show out and show what the kid is. Because you know we're going to beat him in football. So let's beat him on a bad field.
Finally, the whole reason we have high school football games in the first place. Halftime.
We are bats circling above the field, disoriented, darting into the stadium spotlights, bouncing off the vibrations of the brass section. Yet even without direction, seemingly blind, we are soaring above ourselves, free in the embrace of Friday night. Our youth is liquid music dancing beneath our stiff skin, within bodies we sometimes flaunt, but mostly hate. We laugh, heads tilted back, hips wide and tossing on rhythmical wind. We are bats fighting the ancient pull of the moon. The concrete tide of time is already starching us into rigid maturity. To remember what we are already losing, forgetting the beauty that we find in the newness of each other, ourselves, our lives. For each undiscovered experience is treasured when first found, and our time for beginning seems too swiftly swept away.
I never got to know the joys of high school football season. The school I went to was mostly Jewish, so we didn't have much of a football team. We did have a great debate team, though.
I can't think of a nicer place to bring your wife on your 23rd anniversary than the oldest lighted field in continuous use in the United States. Happy anniversary to the Whitakers, who are celebrating their 23rd anniversary here tonight behind the Callaway building.
What is this I smell in your breath? No tobacco.
Nope.
Good man.
Happy year.
All right, that's great.
I started smoking and quit all before I was legally able to buy them.
Around Thanksgiving, I met a ghost. James, who had graduated the year before and was back for a visit, was Michael's best friend the last year of his life. I'd never met him before because, like Danny, his parents were divorced when he was a kid.
Divorced parents don't communicate. They both booked me a reservation on the same flight. They don't seem to find the humor in the situation.
You never get over the death of a child. If you're lucky, you learn to live with it. Even today, 9 years later, I can't answer when someone asks me how many children I have. So running into James and hearing him talk about Michael was quite a shock.
I remember the last time I saw him. I rode up on my bike, and he said he was about to leave somewhere. And I said, oh, okay, I'll see you later. And he said, yeah. And I just rode off.
That's how Michael died. I'll see you later. And he was gone. He'd been hit by a car the year before and had recovered from his injuries, but one morning the next summer I dropped him off at his day camp, and that afternoon he collapsed from a massive stroke and never woke up. And that's when I learned how relentless time can be. It was like every moment of every day was pulling me farther and farther away from my son, building an endlessly growing canyon between me and Michael, who would never be more than 9 years old, while I just kept getting older. But then I ran into James, and it hit me that Danny isn't the only one I'm looking for here. I'm also trying to find Michael, to know what he would have been like, what life would have been like had he lived more than 9 years.
It's like taking a rock out of a small creek. I mean, the current's going to change. Some people may not notice it, but others will.
Yeah, I became really paranoid after Michael died. It's just I hated to do anything alone. I was afraid. Every time a car went by me when I was walking down the street, I'd freak out. Especially if somebody stopped to ask me directions.
Yeah.
I would completely, my heart would start beating. I'd get this huge rush of adrenaline, and it would just freak me out completely. It changed everything about me, because up until that point, I'd always had Michael. And Michael was there, and I just always tagged along with him and his friends, and I never really developed a group of friends of my own. And all of a sudden that was gone, and it just completely had changed the way I reacted to other people. And it kind of, it was tough for a while because I didn't know how to make friends, because I never really had to make friends. And it took me a long time to get out of that and become more open around other people. But I think if Michael hadn't died, it would have kept me more introverted and kept me away from other people. I wouldn't have been able to get as close to other people.
All right, let's take a vote. Let's take a vote. Take a vote. Who wants to go to IHOP?
Tortillas.
One, two, three, four, five. Who wants to go to Waffle House?
I don't want to go to IHOP.
Okay. The more we get together, together, the more we get together, the happier we'll be. Dog's your friend, my friend, and my friend is your friend. The more we get together, the happier we'll be.
Body's usually like, yes, eat, I'm hungry, and your mind is like, no, 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 there's way too much of me here, I have to be thinner.
For Danny and Mary Ellen, football season was bittersweet. He was falling more and more in love, but her struggle with anorexia almost consumed her.
When you're really into it, you can get some pretty nice highs, actually, from it. Just like these feelings of victory when you look around and count up all the calories in everybody else's lunch and realize that, you know, yours has the fewest by far, or you turn down a cookie or something.
All this time I've been feeling like something was happening between us, and that there was potential for something to happen between us. But nothing ever did, and so finally, last summer, it took me a long time, but I finally told her how I felt about her.
Knowing Danny, it wasn't very long, it wasn't very eloquent or anything, it was just, like, we've been spending a lot of time together, and...
What'd you tell her?
That I was in love with her. And she looked at me and said, well...
Why did you say that? And I was like, well...
Wasn't the reply I was expecting.
I think we're actually maybe a little bit more comfortable then, because we knew where we stood.
Small things would happen where I would be trying hard to keep things going between us, and I just didn't feel like she was doing much to reciprocate. She just wasn't attempting that much in our friendship, and so I just decided, well, I'll just see what happens if I stop trying. And I stopped trying. She didn't notice.
Baby, baby, I'm aware of where you go. Each time you leave my door. It's kind of funny how it goes with other people, because you want people to notice, and you want to be special, and you want other people to see that you're special. But you don't want anybody to say anything about it, because this is your secret addiction and you have to protect it. And if someone else notices, they might try to take it away from you.
I watched you walk down the street, knowing your other love you meet.
And it's just so insane. And it's a circle you can't get out of, it seems. I mean, you'll think, oh, I really do have to get better, and you'll eat. And then you'll think, oh no, I just ate. That was stupid. I have to get thin again. So you get thin again, so you start to panic. I mean, it's just crazy, and it wears you out. It takes all your energy.
But this time, before you run to her, leaving me alone to cry, think it over, haven't I been good to you?
It's just so degrading. I mean, I want to think I'm above this. What am I doing? Why am I so concerned with how I look? What does that have to do with anything? I mean, I sat through all these silly little first grade hype lessons about love yourself however you are. I mean, I'm better than this. I am not this superficial.
Spencer always treated her like second best. And so, from what I gather, one of the reasons she became anorexic was trying to perfect herself for him, trying to get more attention from him. And it made her really mad and made her really depressed that he was always treating her like this. And finally, after she'd been anorexic for a while, he told her that he couldn't handle her being sick all the time and dumped her.
And it's also scary to, for a moment, just sort of catch a glimpse of yourself and realize that there's just this skeleton there, and it's like someone has taken cellophane and just sort of wrapped it around, and you can see every little jut and all these muscles, and it's just gross. And it's like, this isn't me. Where did the rest of me go? It's just not there. That's terrifying.
Stop! In the name of love, before you break.
And she told me, well, she did realize that she loved me, but it wasn't she wasn't really in love with me.
So I told him that, and I was like, you know, this doesn't change anything. I'm not, like, in love with you or anything. I just realized that I love you, and you do so much for me. I have no idea what I would do if you weren't here.
Usually in a relationship, she would feel something more than just friendship for me if she were at this point in a relationship, but she didn't. She just didn't feel it for me. But she really did love me as a really good friend. And so that's where things have basically been since then. There are a lot of rumors flying around school about me and Marilyn.
What?
Just that she's leading me on and that she's treating me really bad and stuff like that. And also that Chris has told me once that he thinks I'm being really unfair to Mary Ellen because the way I'm acting keeps her from ever wanting another boyfriend. That kind of made me mad.
What do you think will happen when she goes away to college?
I don't know. Probably get a girlfriend.
Late in November, the team made the playoffs. But then, one night in December, football season at Decatur High came to a sudden close when they lost a playoff game they should have won. We spent Christmas in Los Angeles, where I had grown up, and that's when Danny told me that things were decidedly looking up for him.
I went over there and talked for a little bit, and then finally she took her a little while, but she told me that she decided she really did like me and she was ready for a relationship. And so we kind of a couple now.
1, 2, 3. It was concert season, and life went on at Decatur High.
Thank you.
Danny and Mary Ellen were finally together, and they were avoiding me. So I watched as best I could.
My thoughts could create a whole new me. Would just be totally different from who I really am.
Of course, then you can also argue that your thoughts are who you really are, and the whole you.
So I'm not really me?
Exactly.
Yeah! Danny and Mary Ellen are so much alike, it's eerie. My wife, Mary Ann, Danny's stepmother, jokes that they shouldn't get married because their children would never be able to tell them apart.
But they got to play,
But this whole situation was starting to feel, well, a little uncomfortable. I mean, I thought we were friends.
But, you know, still you are my father. And there are just certain things that, you know, I get reluctant to talk to you about.
Everything's just going really smoothly. We both have a lot of fun with each other, that kind of thing.
I get the message. It was time to leave Danny and Mary Ellen alone. This was my chance to get back to the band.
Who you represent? Who you represent? I represent Decatur, cause Decatur got the heat. Oh,
you can't fill my room, though.
Why not? Oh, come on. You gotta let me fill your room.
No.
Why?
No.
My shoes.
Do you actually live in here?
Yeah, I do, actually, live in here. Yeah, here's my band uniform.
You know, I really did hope when I came here that after a while I would just become part of the gang.
Now see, if you promise me it wouldn't get me in trouble, then I can tell you a lot more, because you know when I talk to you I'm like, no, 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 and then you turn on your camera and I shut up, don't I?
Yeah. Oh well, at least I could bug Greg and Amber.
Doesn't she have a great smile? In creative writing, we were doing like Sagittarius, like, you know, the signs.
Zodiac stuff.
Yeah. And she's all into that kind of like frivolous rabble. Anyway, Sagittarius said, you know, I was all like, I'm optimistic and.
No. Okay, I'm sorry.
Somewhere.
I mean, when you were growing up, did you feel like there was no room left for, like, progressive things? Because I really feel like that. I mean, I feel like there's a million people doing a million things at once. And, you know, in music, art, nothing's shocking anymore. And everybody's done every drug, everybody's done, you know, every piece of music. I mean, all the music you hear nowadays is, like, just redone stuff. Every philosophy has been talked over a billion times. Every, you know, there's old geezers out there.
Antonio Smith, would you go to the front of the building, please? Antonio Smith, your party's waiting on you in the front of the building.
You shoot for and high goals? Is the
no, shut up, shut up. It was like, because they're all different. I mean, that's why you can't trust them. Anyway, it said I was, well, I'm sorry, I didn't know. No, it didn't say that I shot for high goals. It said, like, that I'm, like, philosophical and, like, something, and optimistic, and I can be insensitive. And
shut up. I'm sorry, what?
You know, he has a band, and he likes to spend a lot of time playing with the guys. And I feel like such a groupie when I'm over there playing cards.
And, no, but like 6 months away from Sagittarius is supposed to be your perfect match. And that's her, Gemini.
Really?
Yeah.
My two brothers are my stepmom and my dad's kids. And
the other one is Grayson.
Right.
So they
live with my dad.
Oh, okay. So you live with your half sister.
But it's the other half.
Right. I live with my mom and
all
her
the kids
husband
she's ever had.
And clear his off kid.
Okay.
How about name an emotion? Try and challenge me. Name an emotion and make me play it.
Thriftiness.
But my stepbrother is my stepdad and his ex-wife's kid.
Just our generation has got to feel stifled. And if they don't, they're just they're too hopeful for my taste.
But while the world weighs heavily on Greg,
3, 4.
Bert's pummeling his way through it.
Somebody might look at me and say, damn, man, you're a bad person because you break all these laws or whatever, because I do. I break a shitload of laws. But see, I don't really break any real laws, not real laws to me. I'm saying there's laws against the state, and there's laws against humanity and God. I don't break none of them laws. Smoking weed or fucking, like, man, it's against the law to fuck doggy style, man. I mean, what kind of shit is that?
And we have a lovely bird that, I want a fish. But we have a bird. That's in a little bag because he's dead. Still in its cage where it was, you know, when it died and that kind of thing. Just because it was like my grandmother's favorite bird. And, you know, I guess she just didn't want to bury it, so it's still there.
So is it a clear plastic bag? And you
mm-hmm. It's like a little sandwich bag. I don't even think it's like a Ziploc thing. It's just, you know, folded over.
Erin lives with her mother, her sister Amy, and her grandparents. She reminds me of Marilyn, the only normal family member on that TV show, The Munsters.
My mother, she's like a teenager, which is good because, well, I guess kind of good because then she's more of my friend than my mother, who tells me the right and wrong things to do. She just kind of listens to whatever and tells me stuff about her life that most teenagers probably don't know. And
My mom's like the ultimate sweetest person in the world. Like she thinks damn's a cuss word. And I mean, she's just always like nice and kind of goofy, but not really goofy. But see, she's cool because, man, I mean, it takes a strong woman to have me as a son. Cause she stuck by me when I got suspended and got arrested and all the other crazy shit I've done my whole life. And so she's always been there. Like, I mean, no matter how many times I lied to her, you know, she was always cool. And so now I'm real straight with her. But yeah, I love my mom more than anything.
And so when she comes home drunk, Amy goes upstairs and I stay downstairs and put a cloth. I wet a cloth and put it over her eyes because she usually has a headache and that kind of thing. And just put it over her eyes so that she'll just, you know, kind of calm down, that kind of thing. And then just lay down with her and put my arms around her to let her know that someone's there. And so she won't be jumping all around and stuff.
And it was Bert and Aaron's friendship that carried them through their senior year.
Tell me another letter. Hey, baby, C. Which one?
A.
All right, go turn in my test for me. Aaron did my whole test.
Don't put that on the camera.
Put that on the camera. Yeah.
Bert, I guess.
I don't know how to do this, man. Look, man. Look, let me show you how I got
screwed. Told me to sit here and tell him all these letters, and he just wrote them down. Didn't even look at the problem.
I'm not in the mood. See, because look, man, my teacher fucked me up, man. She gave me 1 A, and see, I needed 1 B. Always fucking.
Gosh,
why are you always making me use them kind of words too?
I don't make you do anything. Every time you see me, you take something, writing pencil out of my hand and write that word on my paper.
She won't even say it. She just calls it that word.
I don't like that word. That word is a yucky word.
What word?
I don't know.
You don't know what word you're talking about?
Mm-mm. I don't know. I think the problem with me going to a psychologist is that I've already told so many people my entire life story. That I'm getting bored with telling it. You do it.
Tell me the B. I say fuck every day. I say it 3 times in one sentence. And I'm the only person in the world who can do that. Trust me. I say fuck, that motherfucker just, man, fuck it. Say 3 times.
There's no need for that, Bert.
Oh, fuck you. I don't want to go to detention. Hey, Holmes, look.
Don't go.
I didn't
go
yesterday.
You have a drill team meeting.
Yeah. Coach Bell, I have a drill team meeting. I'll have to go.
Coach Bellis, talking about hashish. That boy, I'm telling you, he talks.
Hey, Greg. Detention hall has been canceled.
Yes! Oh, you see that? That's talking about power right there, boy. That power. Funk you, my man. And it's the happiest day of my life, and it's all because of you. It's all because of you. I'm gonna cry. No detention hall. That's just great, man. I'm telling you.
Kids, I don't know what's wrong with these kids today. Kids, who can understand anything they say? Kids, they are disobedient, disrespectful oafs. Noisy, crazy, sloppy, lazy loafers. And while we're on the subject, kids, you can...
I used to sing "The Times They're a-Changin'" in our living room just to piss my parents off. So who am I or anyone in my generation to cringe at whatever teenagers come up with today?
Well, let me tell you a little story about living in Decatur. If some niggas run up on you, build it now and not later. But I'll be damned if I go out.
And besides, we've got a lot to learn from these kids, like how they navigate this divided world.
Hey, hey, get off me, man.
You know I had to be asking.
Too much love. I got weight on me.
But when I came to the cave, it just...
Yeah, it's there,
you know what I'm saying? But some people cool only look at like racism. Now I look at like who you cool with and who you just don't, who you like, you know what I'm saying? Who you just don't like and all that.
There he is.
I just came to the realization that it didn't really, that people weren't going to judge me based on my color. So why should I judge them based on their color? Why should I be, why shouldn't I not feel at ease around black people when I feel at ease around white people? It just seemed really stupid.
The black kids in the band mostly will hang out with white people, but the ones outside the band don't usually.
Yeah. Because, I mean, you're stuck with them for hours and hours every day. You have to.
They have no choice.
Yeah, then you get used to them, and so you become friends.
They don't like the way I am. They just got to keep on going to the next person down the line, trying to make them change.
They say you changed.
Yes, she did change. But hang out with us.
But it wasn't to make it. It wasn't
for her. Her father said she's going through a stage.
I do what I do for myself, not for nobody else.
What she did to be with us?
For myself.
To be with us?
Don't flatter yourself. I did.
But I got jacked one time for my starter jacket when I was young, and you know, for some reason that made me get a little racist for a little while, and that was just stupid, you know. And I've learned, and I mean, I guess you just grow up learning stupid shit. And the thing is that the generation that we're in now just needs to unlearn all that crap everybody spit at you.
Some kind of cages go like this, but wasn't like twirling sticks and all that kind of stuff. I bunch up this.
Now, you remember that Eric's goal was to be a drum major. Well, it turns out that at Decatur High, you can be disqualified if other teachers in the school vote against you, and that's what happened to Eric. So he tried out for leader of the drum section instead.
You'd really like to make everybody happy, and, you know, and I wish I could tell both of you exactly what you want to hear. I wish I could. And I can. You both made it. You were both the drum captains, and I need two of them, and it'll be you two. Eric, figure that out.
Hell, man.
Until right at the end.
By the way, on learning, I just learned this in a workshop. Shh, listen carefully. It talks about how we learn. Look up here, please. 33% is learned by sight. So watch. Be here on time. Okay, you saw, okay. Now close your eyes. Close your eyes, everybody. 11% is through hearing. Be on time! Okay, thanks.
I kind of had a little self, what is it, when you just realize something about yourself?
Just self-realization.
Yeah. I ran upstairs because I was just not studying for a test or something, and I was like, Dad, you know how all my life I've been told you're not lazy or dumb, you just have a learning disability. And I said, but Dad, I really don't want to work.
Why are you taking time? Oh my God.
Kate and Cameron, who are among the millions of kids in this country diagnosed with attention deficit disorder, have an interesting perspective on their lives.
My family, I refer to my family as a normal family, basically because everybody's, it's like 60 or 70% divorce rate now in the United States. So I refer to us as a normal family because my mom and dad are divorced. I think they divorced when I was 6 or 7.
It's like I've been noticing a lot lately that the traits that I picked up from my parents, like, in fact, I was talking to my dad about it because I blame him a lot for some things I don't like about myself, and I'm trying to get over that, but it's like that's where I got my learning disability from, is from my dad.
Actually, you know, that everybody goes, well, did you feel bad? Do you think it was your fault? I didn't feel like it was my fault. I was actually happier once they were divorced, basically because they didn't fight anymore.
I was telling him about that. I was like, you know, I've been feeling very hostile towards you because he's a shrink and he wants me to tell him all this stuff, you know. And he's like, okay.
He's a shrink and he has a hard time paying attention?
We have to play.
Do you mean when it hurt people's feelings, if they were spilling their guts? And he was like, what? Sorry, what'd you say?
And you get more presents for Christmas. People overlook that, but you get more presents for Christmas, especially when you have stepfamily. My dad is remarried.
And they're the ones who introduced me to the teenage drug culture of the 90s, the one 9 out of 10 doctors recommend.
Everybody needs a pill for something.
Yeah. If you have problems, you need a pill. It's like Brave New World.
The thing is,
you know?
Is I didn't pay attention because I wasn't interested.
But my mom would take me to church or whatever and have to have me calm. She would give me Ritalin. So I thought I had to take Ritalin to be appropriate.
But I didn't like Ritalin. It made me not want to eat at all. Like, so I got real skinny and I was always feeling bad because I didn't eat.
I've been taking it for so many years. I started in first grade and stopped taking it on my own in 11th grade.
But it is funny, they prescribe drugs for everything. Are you depressed? Are you too happy and hyper? Do you feel anxious about things? Do you eat too much? Do you eat too little?
Marijuana is one thing, and beer is the same kind of thing, but when you have a doctor who you trust, and somebody you think is telling you something for your own good, and when you put that trust in the doctor, then you believe what he says. I have been seeing a psychiatrist, and I talked to him for a while. I guess on the fourth visit, or no, the first visit, he prescribed me Prozac.
When you're on Prozac and stuff, I don't think that stuff really does anything. It's just like, well, most people, when they take it, they think, hey, I'm taking a drug that's supposed to make me not depressed, so therefore I'm going to be not depressed. So they're not depressed.
I think I have perfectly normal reason to be anxious right now. And to be maybe not so charming.
It seems that every generation passing through these halls tries to memorialize itself, to scratch proof of its existence into the unhearing concrete walls. But what really matters are the laughs, the shouts, the sheer noise of the living, the ones who, in the short time they're here, breathe life into them. That spring, I had a dream about Michael. He was a teenager, and I was very excited because he could finally tell me what he would have been like had he lived. But he just turned to me and smiled sweetly and said, "I'm not." But then the next day, back at Decatur High, the kids were all there, and Danny was there, and it was time for the prom.
What do you think? I think I kind of like that.
The chat.
Back then, my friends and I were too hip for that sort of thing. Instead, we all got stoned and went to the beach to watch the sunrise over the Pacific Ocean. But unfortunately, the sun rises in the east, and so we sat staring out over an empty sky until about 9 o'clock when we realized it was coming up behind us. And we were the smart kids. And while Aaron contemplated leaving Decatur, Bert ended his school year with a run-in with the law.
So he pulls me over, and when he pulls me over, I haven't had an 8-ball in my lap, which was stupid, but still. So I hand that shit back to Brad McCullough, who's in the car with me. And so he pulls me over, takes me out of the car. You know, you're a little punk bitch, blah, blah, blah. I'm just like, yeah, okay, whatever. So then he makes me do these three. He asked me if I had a drink, and there's a principle of the thing is I'm just not going to say, yes, I have been. Although, yeah, I know he was going to say in less than a second, and yeah, I smelled it. But I was like, no. He's like, are you sure? And I was like, well, okay, yeah. But, you know, it's just there's a principle behind that shit.
When I first found out I was accepted to college, it was a very good feeling to, you know, to know that someone really wanted me to go. And so, I don't know, it was kind of a, like, okay, I'm going to get out kind of feeling.
I mean, I learned my lesson. The lesson was not to get caught, but, I mean, it's just, but now I understand it. Well, I mean, I know the law will fuck you more, but it's just that I personally feel I should live my life the way I want to live it, but, I mean, now I have very little choice. I mean, I've known for a while, it's about time that I grew up a little bit and quit fucking around. Well, I mean, I'm more grown up than most of these people, but, you know, start taking a little bit more responsibility, quit getting fucked up all the time, you know, straighten up a little bit, maybe get a job.
I don't know, because of financial aid and stuff, it's kind of, I don't know, financial aid has, like, brought me down because it's very hard for me to fill out that little form because I don't really have a whole lot of help from my family, which is what I need it from because they're involved in the whole process and...
I don't know. I guess it's time for me to shape up a little bit anyway, quit fucking off all the time and, you know, I mean, you had to do it sometime.
I'm ready to go, but I'm not ready to go.
What do your parents do?
My mom is the dean of students, Agnes Scott, and my dad's a lawyer. Thank God my dad's a lawyer.
Thank you.
Just before the end of the year, Danny told me that next year he and some friends would be putting out an underground paper at Decatur High.
Are we going to write about, like, school events, or are we going to have, like, editorials?
Maybe editorials about school events.
The kid really knows how to make his old man proud.
1, 2, 48, go!
My time with the band was ending, and I'd gone pretty far with a lot of the kids. But not quite far enough with one.
I'm gonna die.
How would you describe your family, Dan?
You come from a broken home. I don't understand how you and Mom ever got along. You two are so incredibly different. Put out by yourself. What was that fight about that you guys had in the car on the way back from the airport?
Here it is. One of those moments in every divorced parent's life when your kid asks you that kind of question. And your choice is to tell the truth then and there, or once again, chicken out. You know what I was thinking of doing? I'm actually going to try to sit down and write a letter to you, because it's easier to write something like this, to try to explain your mom's and my relationship and what, you know, what happened. The letter. I guess it's a lot easier making a movie than being a dad. There's a lot in my life that I'm not proud of. I nurtured my own adolescence into my 30s and built a history that, along with Michael's death, I can't escape. But does it have to tower over Danny too? I know that I'll never see a precocious 9-year-old without my heart freezing for a moment, and the divorce is now part of me. But Danny's life was just getting started then. Maybe in a way these things should fade from his memory and let him go.
I have two separate trains of memory. Memories with you and memories with Mom and Mike. Memories with Mom and Mike didn't last much longer, but then I just had memories with Mom and then memories with you. And it became memories with Mom and memories with you and Marianne. And it just kind of seems like, I'm definitely leading one life and I know I'm going back and forth, but when I just think back on stuff that happens with me and Mom, it's stuff that happened with me and Mom. Then I think back with about stuff that happened with me, you and Marianne, stuff that happened with me, you and Marianne. And my memories, like when I'm thinking back, reminiscing, my memories don't combine. I don't go from something that happened between here and it kind of like leads me into something that happened with Mom. Those trains just are on separate tracks.
Finally getting used to these buildings, and the end of the school year was closing in.
Thank you.
At what point do you feel like you could say, I'm not anorexic anymore? I'm conquered this.
Around Christmas, I decided that
I didn't want to be anymore. And that was a really rough time. Really rough. And when I came to terms with that, I could finally come to terms with him. Thanks for waiting. And January was pretty bad because I was trying to convince myself that I was over it. And a lot of ways I was a lot better. Mm-hmm. But it was just so hard to let go, especially since my body was changing. And I could tell myself that I was really ready to get over it, but then it was a lot harder to deal with actually doing it. Guess what?
What?
I got into Williams. I got $19,000 a year from Wellesley.
You got what?
$19,000 a year from Wellesley.
Wow, does that mean you can afford it?
I don't know. But it's a good start.
Danny knew that Mary Ellen would soon be going away to college, but he hoped that somehow they could find a way for their relationship to continue after she left. And for Amber, who was only a sophomore, Greg's graduation was a familiar crossroads.
She left me already. So, I don't really want to talk.
I mean, when I was little, I moved like 8 times in the course of like 2 years, so when I got to elementary school, I didn't fit in at all, and so ever since then, I think I cannot handle changes that I'm not, like, that I can't expect. You know, I just can't deal with them. And so when I think that when I found out that he was accepted to Warren Wilson and he was going to be 4 hours away and I wasn't going to see him, that was a big change, and I had to prepare myself before, and so it was like I just distanced myself. I can't handle being hurt by that. I just wasn't gonna play the game where everything was gonna be fine and then all of a sudden he was gonna leave me one day.
I never thought that it was a really good idea to keep relationships going when one person goes off to college. And not, I mean, I don't think that everything should just stop no matter what you feel, but just planning on keeping it going just doesn't seem wise to me, because it seems like the person who's left at home, just there's just a big void there, and they're not letting something else fill that. And the person away is having their growth stunted. And it just seems unfair and unwise.
Then suddenly it was over, and I was left feeling foolish with my camera in my hand. I wanted to cry, stop. Wait, we just got started here.
Yeah, baby!
Mary Ellen is also our star student this year at Decatur High School.
I have a generous son. It isn't easy letting your father tag along all year, especially when he's got a camera. You never know what he'll find out about you, or what you'll find out about him. I guess we'll always have our hidden places, but when I look at Danny now, I think, or hope, that maybe, just maybe, I found my son. this is Danny's senior portrait. It's just about all I see of the kid these days. He's loving his senior year, and that underground paper that he and his friends are putting out is causing quite a stir at Decatur High. Mary Ellen did go off to college. They're not a couple, but Danny tells me they're better friends than ever. Bert's charges were dropped, and get this, he got a summer job as a counselor at a church day camp. He and Aaron are off to different schools, and, well, I don't imagine they'll ever have friends like each other again. Greg and Amber tried getting back together again over the summer, but it didn't work out. Kate and Cameron kicked their drug habits, and as Kate put it, they're starting their real lives. Eric's leading the drum section, and Chris is still trying to find that one magic pickup line. Time keeps speeding up, but my mother assures me that when you get to your 70s, you go back to counting the days. And me? Well, Marianne and I have been married 6 years now, and somehow the past doesn't weigh as much as it used to. I do that irritate you?
Stick a damn camera in my face all the time.